clearly this is a wonderful thing to do in London, is to go to the aviary in the London Zoo, and often see there actually the kinetic aviary that is quite built in London. And the idea was really to have an aviary which changes its form according to the wind and also according to the mood of the bird, so a structure which is in permanent transformation. So these are just a few thoughts about the fun parts, and I don't know really if I could talk more
I think now we know, or rather Francesca knows what to do and the artists can get prepared. And wasn't the early years of the Pompidou a little bit like the Fun Palace?
It's very interesting that you mentioned the early Pompidou years, because they lead us back to Pompidou then, and maybe as close as it got really for the Fun Palace to be realized, but also the earlier years of Pompidou then, when we got at the modern museum in Stockholm, which leads us back to the now somehow. And I think, I mean, Houdin continued his experiences from Stockholm then at the Pompidou, and particularly his sort of first big exhibitions, which were very transdisciplinary, projects had certainly to do with this. But interestingly enough, it has never really been realized on a mass scale. It's maybe more smaller structures where the transdisciplinary continued over time. And interestingly enough, in very big structures, there is an imminent or inbuilt tendency that then, little by little, maybe the departments are more independent and more autonomous, and maybe less rigidly created. And that's maybe why the Fun Palace idea for such a rather small structure for the classical century can be an interesting model.
So in a way, I think Hans, you gave us lots of things to think about here and discuss. But I think one thing that you emphasized that could be interesting is that it's not about building a new building and putting art in it. It's about creating a structure that is more flexible and that can somehow accommodate the multidisciplinary approach, no?
Yeah, it's also a content machine. I think what is very important is the idea that eventually we start to think also more about what institutions can be as a content machine, and how actually maybe that what happens inside is maybe more important than the one to subdue any existing building, and it's maybe not about having to build up a new kind of gigantic big infrastructure.
In a way, the Moderna Museet, which is, you know, where I grew up, was in Stockholm, was very much like this. It was not so much about, it was not a new building then, it was just an old military complex. And Tom Schoenkin, wow. Did you take off?
They are strange downgrades.
Hans, I say thanks so much for being part of this for a few minutes, and we will continue here and have a productive day in Madrid. Thanks.
Have a great day.
Yes, thanks.
Bye.
Gesture, what is it, what's the new institution? But from a perspective perspective of a local artist in the best sense of the word, and someone working out of there but interested in things outside, what is it that you would need?
I think it's a playground which is not there yet, because we always have to convince everyone there, you know, what we're doing, and if we do something like a weird thing in a museum or something, then it, you always have to convince. I think this is like, for me, actually, I really like this idea, and I think about it, I think if you could do everything, you could have a bakery there for some time, and you could have a cinema, and you could have some concerts, like rock concerts, and you combine all this together, and it has this openness to it, so it's really, because we are very open, we do this in our own studios, or in our own homes, and in our kitchen, everything is you know, decided, so this is going to be a playground, and it's very, very interesting for us.
So in a way, it's an institution that can accommodate that kind of lively, multidisciplinary approach that is already there, no?
Yeah.
Rather than building something that becomes too strict. Maybe, Ali, you can say a few words about what you said.
No, I was just thinking about, because I think I would like to see the place like kind of, I mean, first of all, not to be analyzed or structured too much, you know, and I have to go a little bit, like, you know, tell a little history. Klingenbein was established in 2003, and we have been working for, you know, close to 1 year, when the National Bank of Iceland, which is number one popular in Iceland now, you know, approached us, and they had this 5,000 square meter building, really rough. And they said, do you want it? You can have it. We will pay heat, electricity, whatever. And then in the beginning we had an idea only for visual artists. And then we saw the structure of the house. It was like big rooms, small rooms. We thought, hey, come on, this should be more visual artists. It was like really big. And, you know, it kind of had this organic, strange way, really complex, kind of labyrinth style. And so we put out an advertise in the newspaper, and a lot of people came from different art disciplines. And in the end, there was 140 artists working there on a daily basis. And this was a 2-year project, and it's been turned out. And I think, for me, I mean, Klingenbein was kind of responsible for running it, but at the same time, it became kind of anarchistic. And for me, running it and also being an artist, visual artist myself, was really interesting how different art disciplines start to communicate.
Why is it that there's so many collective projects in I mean, that's my impression.
Before this wasn't.
It wasn't, no. But the Living Art Museum was always a kind of...
Visual art.
Yeah, visual, yeah.
But this was like, this was theater, yeah. Designer, filmmakers, musicians, bands, people working with virtual reality, and I mean, there was so much, many things coming. And I mean, we just jumped into the pool. We had so many ideas, but it kind of started to develop, you know, into some great stuff. And I mean, I remember Francesca brought, you know, Spinozzi, I mean, people that know how he works. I mean, this was paradise for him, because, I mean, he could access musicians. You could access so many different people. And at the same time, it started to communicate with the art academy. I mean, Jason Rose and Bruno Kaplan started to come there and work, and then students were assisting them, and this kind of developed into like so many directions, you know what I mean? It's, it was like also from within, you know? It was like not only attracted from abroad, it became something, a structure from within that was attractive for Icelandic artists to work in.
I always have the feeling that a successful institution must be attractive also locally, otherwise it's just a kind of strange thing that lands there.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, if it's only attractive locally, it becomes too provincial and it's not much to give about. So it's about that double... Yes.
Oh, thank you. Maybe Daniela, to hear a little bit about, I mean, because this is a new initiative, and it would maybe be about joining forces between, you know, between already existing structures. So, from the perspective of TB821, where you're programming things, how would you see that this is, you know, is it what is interesting in this for you?